They censored it. Sign language censorship. I would like to test out the hardness or clarity of the first lines of my most famous poem, which are probably bullshit, actually, in terms of being vague and abstract, because I was a younger poet when I wrote it, and I hadn't quite gotten the idea of really getting it totally clear. But I had some training in modern poetry, particularly Ezra Pound and William Carlos Williams. And their idea was no ideas, but in things. Not to have any generalizations, but through pictures. Or to represent any generalizations they had by a means of a picture. So in spoken language, or in word language, the slogan is no ideas but in things. That's a phrase of William Carlos Williams. But I wasn't very good at that. But what I tried to do is combine picture images in a surrealist way. So the opening lines, let's try them out. Let's try out the opening lines of Howl. I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness. Starving, hysterical, naked. Dragging themselves through the Negro streets at dawn. Looking for an angry fix. Angel-headed hipsters. So that's where my poetry breaks down. Yes, that's where my poetry breaks down, because there I have an abstract word for an actual thing. However, it gets back on the track. The line gets back on the track. Angel-headed hipsters burning for the ancient heavenly connection to the starry dynamo in the machinery of night. Now, I always wondered about that phrase, the starry dynamo in the machinery of night. It has a picture of some kind, but it's a very indefinite picture. The starry dynamo actually could be imagined. But when you have to translate it into sign language, what's left? A starry dynamo. Is there any kind of picture suggested? What's the starry?
Starry.
And the dynamo?
A dynamo is a machine.
Ah. So you have a very general machine there. Not the machine that creates electricity.
Yeah, it is.
When that was translated into sign language...
Powerful.
Was the word dynamo...
Power, you
the creator
power.
Of power. The creator of power. So then it becomes...
Something like that, yeah.
Then it becomes a question of the subtlety of the sign language.
You know, the signs, well, because of the simple fact that we have only two hands.
Yes.
And after a while, you start to duplicate configurations of, we have to make compound signs, add a second and a third sign to get at one meaning. Something like the Chinese language, right?
Yes. What is the
almost the same?
So, what is the fate of surrealism in sign language? Are you at all familiar with surrealist poetry?
Yes. Some. Yes.
The definition was a very interesting picture. The original definition of surrealism by André Breton was the meeting of an umbrella and a sewing machine on an operating table. What kind of sense does that make? The meaning of an umbrella and a sewing machine at an operating table.
A dolly.
Yes, exactly. Yes. The putting together things which are opposite, which don't belong together, but when you see them together, they're really funny. And they make a whole new, a new universe. So I was influenced.
You see, we also have fingers, but
yeah.
So it's no reason why a combination of sounds with fingers pattern conveys the meaning of the poem. So I liked your poem yesterday, Bird Brain.
Yes.
You did a marvelous job. Yes. Will you do that today?
Okay.
It's great poem.
In a minute, but I just there's a couple other lines I want to check out from here.
Okay.
My favorite line in Howl is who sat all night in submarine light of Bickford's cafeteria, floated out on the street, and sat through the stale beer afternoon in desolate beer bars, listening to the crack of doom on the hydrogen jukebox. So now what is a hydrogen jukebox in sign language? A hydrogen jukebox. Of course, that refers to a sound thing, the jukebox, anyway. A jukebox is a mechanical record machine in the bars.
I understand, but why do you take that word, hydrogen?
Oh, the hydrogen bomb. The noise of the jukebox is apocalyptic. So the emergence of that kind of rock and roll and that kind of heavy noise is almost like the beginning of the explosion of the end of the world.
Well, then we would have to say, hey, computer death would know, hey, bomb.
Except I was talking, we have the H-bomb now.
The H.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll use the H. Hey, yeah. We'll use the H-bomb.
You would use H-bomb. Yeah.
H-bomb.
I see. That was my favorite phrase, hydrogen jukebox. But it does depend on, it's a very abstract one. It's two concrete things. There's a jukebox, and then there's hydrogen. Hydrogen is real and a jukebox is real. And when you put them together, it makes an unusual kind of jukebox.
Yes, but if I had to sign without thinking of the English words, I would make some kind of compound. There'd be several signs that you could use to explain the picture that I might get from those two words.
Yeah, but what I'm wondering is, once it is explained, does any kind of interesting sparkle come through with that combination? Or does that go dead in translation? At least in translation.
Let me try. I don't know if it's what you want.
That looks like it. That looks like it. What were the signs you were making?
Okay. Music. Box.
Box. Just interpret.
Music, and then I made a sign to show the shape of the box. A music box. I take a coin, put it in. A record flops over. The needle, it starts spinning and the needle's on it. It starts making noise, and then there's a bomb.
Wow, that's really good. That's a whole other haiku. But what's good about it is like it's a whole complete poem, because to my interpretation that means when you put music in a box and have to pay for it and it becomes mechanical repetition, it might lead to a noise that might blow up the world. You know, you're talking about the whole nature of the mechanical, technological, putting human music into a box with money, causing an explosion, which is a haiku in itself. And there's a logical jump in that. It's a whole other poem. Mine and another layer of it. It's great. That's really interesting.
So you said say Pat do some other things sometimes. Yeah. Because the seven ages of men in Shakespeare.
Forgot the words. I can show one favorite poem of mine.
Fine.
Langston Hughes. Dreams. Do you know that one? You want me to write it up? On the
chair? Sure. Is he good at that? Yeah. So for him, poetry is all pure picture, no sound at all, never any sound element.
Remarkable.
That's a difficult
Langston Hughes.
Langston Hughes, a black poet, he wrote that. No sense of rhythm, because I never heard sound. But I want to translate that into a visual image. So I can't sign the first line as it says, hold fast to dreams. I need to set up things first.
Yeah, but I think that's because that line is very abstract. It's worse than hydrogen jukebox.
Okay. Let me try.
Master of pictorial poetry in the 20th century is William Carlos Williams. has he been much worked with in terms of deaf language and sign language? Are you familiar with the wheelbarrow? How is William Carlos Williams? His most famous poem is "The Red Wheelbarrow." How many people have heard of it? How many have not heard of it? And of the deaf, how many have heard of "The Red Wheelbarrow"? And how many have not heard of it? Raise your hand if you've not heard of it. Okay, then let's do that one. Can you do that? It's "So much depends upon a red wheelbarrow glazed with rainwater beside the white chickens." But let's have a big formal one, like a big show of it. Can you do that one?
Write it down.
Yes, sure. Yeah. It's the most famous.
I've heard it once twice before.
It's the most famous imagist poem of the century. So I'll write it down. And we'll get started on introducing imagism with a clean slate. I don't remember how it goes in terms of the lines. Oh, actually, I'm sorry. Get it straight. Could Mr. Panara try that? The difficult part, the mysterious part, is "so much depends," the first two lines. The rest is a real clear picture.
Yes, I agree. I'm trying to figure out what the first two lines mean.
Well, actually, I think my interpretation is so much of our intelligence depends on our being able to see that clearly. So much of poetry depends on being able to see a single image, a single picture of real life in all of its luminous detail. So much of our perception depends, and so much of our communication depends on our being able to see precisely and speak precisely about what we can see. Also, maybe so much in the garden depends on the wheelbarrow. So much work in the garden. So the first two lines are like the philosophical, moral, editorial, and they contradict the poem. It may be "so much depends upon" instead of "on." I don't know. Wait a minute. Maybe I was wrong. Probably it means so much importance. Or lots of importance. Or
I feel that if you put the first two lines at the bottom of the poem.
Yes. But I think Williams wanted you to leave you with a picture rather than with the idea. He just wanted the pure picture. So much depends on sort of the excuse for giving the picture. What point puzzled him? That so much depends, or the...
Well, really, I omitted this.
The rainwater? Blaze with rain, yeah.
Yeah, we have to add that, too.
That's very picture. Yeah. That's real picture, though.
That's what, as Pat said, we have to add a compound. Yeah, and that will extend the picture, yeah.
What's
very simple, yeah.
What I find interesting in this is this poem is supposed to be the classic of pictorial simplicity. But it actually isn't. Yes?
The way he handled it, though, he eliminated the stuff.
Yeah.
And it was just implicit.
Yeah.
The way he was looking at it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think in sign poetry, you would have to really set up the picture in all the detail. And it would have the same effect.
And he did set up the picture. The subtle thing glazed with rainwater. That shining thing is like a Vermeer painting. Okay. What? Oh, okay, bird brain, yes.
Well,
nobody can hear it.
Oh, yes. He can get the rhythm. In the sound.
For harmonium, is there any point in doing anything with harmonium? I don't think so. No, we're running out of time.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, for who?
For.
Sure. Well, do both then. But I was interested in trying to follow Jim Cohen's suggestion and do bird brain, or do some lines of bird brain. No, leave it down. So I'll do it with a harmonium. Just combine them both. You have the text?
Bird brain runs the world. Bird brain is the ultimate product of capitalism. Bird brain, chief bureaucrat of Russia, yawning. Bird brain ran the FBI 30 years, appointed by Franklin Delano Roosevelt, and never chased Cosa Nostra. Bird brain apportions wheat to be burned. Keep prices up in the world market. Bird brain never gets laid on his own. He depends on his office to pimp for him. Bird brain offers brain transplants in Switzerland. Bird brain wakes up in the middle of the night and arranges his sheets. I am bird brain. I rule Russia, Yugoslavia, United States, Eastman School of Music, Rochester, RIT. Cubs' baby harp seals and wears their coats to Paris. Bird Brain runs the Pentagon. His brother runs the CIA. Fat ass Bucks. What is fat ass Bucks? Bird Brain is Pope, Premier, President, Commissar, Chairman, Senator. Bird Brain voted Reagan President of the United States. Bird Brain prepares Wonder Bread with refined white flour. Bird Brain wore a mustache and was dictator of Germany the last year of World War II. Bird Brain conceived the final solution to the Jewish problem of Europe. Bird Brain carried it out in gas chambers. Bird Brain outlawed opium on the world market. Bird Brain formed the black market in opium. Bird Brain's father shot heroin into his arms in the hallways of the Lower East Side. Bird Brain organized Operation Condor to spray poison fumes on the marijuana fields of Mexico. Bird Brain got sick in Harvard Square from smoking Mexican grass. Bird Brain arrived in Europe to conquer cockroaches with propaganda. Bird Brain became a great international poet who went around the world singing the glories of Bird Brain. He built the World Trade Center on New York Harbor without planning where the toilets would empty. He began chopping down the Amazon rainforests to build a wood pulp factory on the riverbank. Bird Brain in Belfast throws bombs at his mother's ass. Bird Brain authored the Bible, wrote The Wealth of Nations, wrote Das Kapital. He invented the theory of relativity so that Rockwell Corporation could manufacture neutron bombs in Colorado. Bird Brain's going to see how long he can go without coming. Bird Brain thinks his dong will grow big that way. Bird Brain realized he was a Buddha by meditating. Bird Brain's afraid he's going to blow up the planet. So he wrote this poem to be immortal.
O'clock on the news.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you very much.
What most do you want?
mainly a kind of, you know, just a personal...
Signing.
Yeah.
And you could, the closer the speaker to a poetic utterance, the whole signing changed. It was very interesting. Very interesting because the name of Christ came up so often with the, especially the ministers who spoke, that the word for Christ in signing is and you really got a tremendous sense of what was going on to watch back and forth. Blaze, what did you do? Was that a visual?
Well, sure, that would have. How did they translate glaze? Did anybody notice?
I wasn't.
It was something like this. Something like this.
That's rain.
Fell.
I think that's the rain.
That the glazed was.
That's rain?
I know.
Oh. Oh, snow, this is snow.
A little slower coming down.
Yeah. So, how do we. Are you going to ask me questions or what?
Yeah, and anyone who wants to ask anything, I'd like to have them just jump in too. I'd just like to get you talking. I mean, I don't have any.
I know, but I
yeah, right.
Like what? About what? You know,
well, I'd start out with just when was your first knowledge of Williams? And was there anything, was it at an earlier age than even other poets would have been because you were in Patterson?
Mm-hmm.
Was there a knowledge of, I don't think so. Are we? We're going? Okay.
Okay.
What was your first knowledge of William Carlos Williams?
Well, not much when I was very young, because my father was a poet, and he was known in Paterson, New Jersey, as Paterson's principal poet, Louis Ginsberg. Mm-hmm. And he didn't like Ezra Pound or T.S. Eliot, nor did he like William Carlos Williams, because they all wrote modern poetry without rhymes. Mm-hmm. So my father was a bit upset and maybe a little jealous, because they were considered avant-garde and more famous. However, there was a labor newspaper that began under some friends of my father started, the New Jersey Labor Herald or something like that, from Patterson, or Patterson Press, a weekly. Mm-hmm. And I got interested in Williams because I read a little book of his called The Wedge, written during the war at Columbia College in the browsing room, and it was put out, I think, by Cummington Press, and I didn't understand it at all. Actually, now I read it and it's very clear, mm-hmm. but in those days I couldn't understand it because it didn't rhyme, but I was used to that, and it didn't seem to have the same tinkle-tinkle that regular poetry that I knew of had, and I didn't know why it was so clean and so like a skyscraper or something, so modern. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what he was trying to do. So I arranged through the Patterson Press to go and interview Williams when I was 17 or 18 years old, to go to his house in Rutherford, to his doctor's office, and ask him what he meant, mm-hmm. actually, how he read it, what he was interested in. So I phoned and I got an interview with him, and I went there and I waited in his doctor's office, and then finally he was finished with his patients. And he had a half an hour or an hour to spend with me. He showed me his house and showed me where he writes, upstairs in the room. Then I sat down with him in his in the little doctor's office, and we talked. And I said, "Do you think of yourself as a poet or a doctor?" And he said, "A doctor." I was disillusioned because I thought, "Oh, gee, he's going to think of himself. He's a doctor in disguise. He's a poet in disguise as a doctor."
Uh-huh.
But no, he's a doctor in disguise as a poet.
Uh-huh.
Or he was just putting me on. Or else he just, you know, was giving me very straight for it. He's a doctor. He's a doctor. Then, but he was just trying to get an ordinary thing. Then I said, "Well, what is it you're trying to do?" And he said, "Well," then he showed me his prescription pad, and he had written on it, "I'll kick your eye. I'll kick Y-U-H-E-Y-E, your eye. I'll kick your eye." He said he heard some Polish guy saying that.
Uh-huh.
"I'll kick your eye." He says, "Now how could you put that into iambic pentameter? Or it doesn't fit. You can't measure it that way. I'll kick your eye. I'm looking for a way of measuring the speech around Rutherford, the speech I hear, the talk I hear, the way people talk here." And then I went home and I wrote up this interview. And I was very respectful, because I was really interested, though I didn't still understand him. And it was chopped up by the editor and changed, and the front was changed, and it sounded like I was making fun of him. But I got really upset, and then I got ashamed. Mm-hmm. It was my first experience of journalism, of gutter journalism. And that was supposed to be a left-wing paper, too, or some kind of liberal paper. Then, about a half year later, he read at the Museum of Modern Art, 1948.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to hear him read, and all of a sudden I realized that he was just talking, that there was no trick at all, that the whole reason I didn't understand it was I was looking for a trick, and there was no trick. It was just straightforward statement, straightforward description, somebody like somebody on his front porch telling you what he saw that day, or just talking about what he thinks. And the one line that made a light bulb up over my head that gave me the insight was the end of a poem called "The Clouds," where he says, "The imagination straining after a pismire, a moth, a butterfly," and he ends the poem that way, "straining after a pismire, a moth, a butterfly," he lifted up his hand like that and broke the sentence off. Just like I do when I'm talking sometimes. Or mm-hmm. My father, when I give up. It just ended it like that. And I realized, oh, it's just all the vividness. It's just like talking. Uh-huh. That's all he's doing is talking. His poetry is no different from talking for real. And I said, so that's why the modern poetry is. It's like talking for real.
Uh-huh.
Instead of making up something pretty to sound good. So then I understood what he was doing. So then I went to my notebooks, and I sent him some poems of my own that were rhyme poems that I'd written around Patterson or Columbia University, that were sort of mystical rhyme poems. And I sent it to him with a long letter talking about Kerouac and Burroughs and a few other people, and saying that I was interested in his change of prosody or meter or new meter, but I didn't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to talk with him. Then he sent me back the poems saying, "In this mode, perfection is basic." He said, "No good." I should say, he didn't say these no good. He said, "These aren't so interesting. In this mode, perfection is basic." In the rhymed mode, I should uh-huh. mention that when I saw him, what he looked like, sort of a slightly stooped over, brisk of appearance, big nose, big bony nose. He wrote a poem about you and I, bony nose. He's got a poem about it. High forehead, prominent brow or bone,
mm-hmm.
Kind of a thin face, slightly sunken cheek, a weak mouth in the sense of friendly mouth, not a strong dictator's mouth at all, not a pouting mouth at all, more of almost a womanish mouth, extremely tender eyes, friendly, inquisitive, completely wide open, friendly, inquisitive, no prejudices at all. Odd, like some old lady school teacher who's really friendly. If you've ever had an old lady school teacher who's really friendly in the fourth grade or the fifth grade,
mm-hmm.
just really curious and inquisitive and friendly and looking at you, what are you made of? You know, what are you thinking about? What are you interested in? You little birdie, or like, just really friendly. Inquisitive, I would say, and that was his characteristic, and totally vulnerable, no sense of force or heavy armor or anger or pride, but like a good doctor talking to a baby, sort of like a good doctor relating to a baby, like open, not treating it
receptive,
totally receptive. And at that time, I was gay, and I knew I was gay, and I talked to Kerouac about it. But I didn't want him to know for some reason. I was ashamed. So I told him I wasn't gay. He must have seen through that. And so there was one time, I had written him, then I sent him some poems that I drew out of my journals. I kept journals of prose. And I took a couple of paragraphs and arranged them in lines so that they looked like modern poetry. And those are all over the page, but really straightforward prose lines that describe things like the mill street, the smoke, the alleys, the dye works, all the Negroes climbing around rusted iron by the river, descriptions of the Passaic River and local scenes. And I sent those to him, about seven of them. And he wrote back, "This is it. Have you got any more of these? I shall see that you get a book." It was in my mind. Because I was just trying to imitate what he was doing. You know, I said, well, I think I'll fake it. But what wasn't fake was these were the actual notes I wrote to myself without trying to write poetry, just trying to make sense. The only fake was arranging them in lines, but then that wasn't fake either, because I took a lot of trouble to balance the lines and break it up into phrases as you might speak it.
Mm-hmm.
Break it up into phrases as you might speak it, and lay it out on the page so it had some kind of mindful order, mindful arrangement of the phrasing. Mm-hmm.
And then how did it affect you after that?
I suddenly realized, all I have to do is be myself. I don't have to write poetry anymore. I just be myself and write down what I really think instead of trying to make it into poetry.
Uh-huh.
That the poetry is what I really think already. That it isn't something that you have to make up as if I didn't think it. That the poetry was totally natural, and that if one could be natural and say what one really thinks frankly, vividly, directly, with candor, that was as vivid as you could get. Mm-hmm. And that you only smudged it and made it messy when you try to force it into some kind of old-fashioned form just for the sake of being smart aleck about it. That the whole point of trying to be formalistic was generally being smart aleck and not really saying what you were really thinking. And the weird thing was that he dug what I was really thinking rather than what I was trying to come on with.
Mm-hmm.
He dug my natural thoughts, my natural mind, what I actually just wrote to myself like little suicide notes. Those were the things he dug.
Mm-hmm.
As Kerouac said in Pull My Daisy movie, when he's looking at Gregory Corso and I, who are examining each other's notebooks, little funny scribbled notebooks, and Robert Frank puts his camera on it and he says, they do the little secret scatological scribbles, which is of course what everybody's interested in, rather than what you're going to show the public, you know, as if it's your work of art like Napoleon. So, Whitman liked candor also. I said, because he was writing this big long poem, Patterson, and I'm from Patterson. So I said, and apparently he dug the fact that somebody from Patterson itself, some young kid, slightly crazy but illuminated young kid, would write him back. And it was like a response from the streets.
Mm-hmm.
Like he'd been invoking the spirit of Patterson, and all of a sudden there was somebody that was a little bit sensitive and wrote poems about Mill Street and the smoke and Negroes climbing around rusted iron by the river, which is just like his own eye. So we made an appointment. And he came and picked me up at my house in Patterson. And he said, well, I'll be your date tonight. And we went down to River Street by the Passaic River, which is the neighborhood where I grew up. And I showed him all the archetypal Kerouacian image houses and drugstores and markets and backyard fences and porches that I mythologized to myself or with Kerouac when I was growing up.
Mm-hmm.
The archetypal memory places in my existence in Patterson, to give him some sense of the ground or how it looked to me. So we took a big walk by the Passaic River and found one spot where like, the houses had been torn down and there was actually a little rubble and you could actually get to the water. And I went down, and I started digging up the rubble like an archaeologist and saying, well, now here's an old razor blade and here's an old toothpaste cap and condoms and pots, steel knives, nothing stainless. That is to say, just whatever was there as being the poetry of Patterson, the poem of the riverbank. Mm-hmm. What was the accumulated, worn out, thrown away lifetimes? And then I went with him around to a, there's a little drainage pool behind one of the factories up around Mill Street in Patterson, near the falls, which was a pond. The dye factory, they had dyed the silk there. Patterson's a silk city, and they had a little pond with runoff water from the factory. It was a place where kids used to go naked in the summer and swim. Right in the middle of the factory buildings, the industrial mm-hmm. landscape, there was this little pastoral pond, like an old pond in 19th century American paintings. And I remember going there as a kid, and it's totally astounded. It was the first place I ever saw everybody naked, all those guys naked. And I was too young to recognize sex, but there was something that stirred me. And I remember, so I told Williams about something that I'd seen when I was about 7. There was this older big bully with a little pubic hair, and there's this little shivering runt. And the big bully was threatening and persecuting the little shivering runt, and they had gotten across the pond onto a little ledge of sandstone backed by a fence, and on the right-hand side was a 20-foot mill pond drop, a little waterfall drop. And the bully was threatening to push the kid over. And everybody else was sort of indifferent, and there was this kid shivering, blue-bodied, screaming of terror as he was being pushed closer and closer to the waterfall. Mm-hmm. And I still remember that as partly as an erotic image, partly as like a fear image. So I told Williams about it. So I was trying to deliver him what was the psyche of Patterson, mm-hmm. actually. And that was the strongest image I remember from childhood in the streets of Patterson. Then we went home, he took me home, and then I sat outside my house with him in the car and asked him, what is he trying to do? He says, what I'm trying to do is squeeze pictures into little lines. I'm trying to take a picture and squeeze it into little narrow lines. Mm-hmm. I remember using the word squeeze, squeezing a picture into a few words. He talked a little about his sense of relative measure, and about what he was interested in, and measuring the American language. But it was more of the practical way of saying, I'm afraid like I kick your eye, how do you can't figure it out by the old-fashioned way, you just have to listen to what's around you and use that. Then remember one time went over to his house, he had a date with the Rutherford Poetry Society, or the Fairlawn Poetry Society. Fairlawn was a little suburban town right outside of Patterson, and there was some kind of literary society, and they invited him over. And hardly anybody invited him anywhere, so it was a big honor for the guy to go locally. This is 1950, say, to go locally to some old ladies' poetry society in the suburbs. So he invited me to come along. I forgot what the whole thing was going on. It was just sort of talk and tea. And, mm-hmm. But I remember asking him, what do you think about T.S. Eliot? He said, that bastard. I said, well, what do you got against him? He said, well, once we met, and he said, he was a snob. And I felt he insulted me. He said, Eliot said, oh, Dr. Williams, so charming to meet you. I just really do appreciate your characters. I think we should have more of them. And Williams imitated Eliot saying that. He said, that bastard, characters, he was laying that English trip on me, you know, like the character of the happy warrior. The character is a poetic form or a literary form of the 18th century, is it? Where you I don't know quite what it is, actually. It's a...
comes from Theophrastus.
Uh-huh. Oh, so it's actually a classic, and then taken over into Jacobean literature or something like that, or 18th century literature, in which you do a portrait of someone of some kind, and a very formal thing, maybe by 18th century or 17th century, in rhymed couplet or something. Mm-hmm. or Pope has done it, or Dryden. Who wrote the character of the Happy Warrior? It's a famous poem.
I thought that was from Wordsworth.
Maybe. So Eliot said to William, oh, I read like the bareheaded proletarian woman. She opens, takes off her shoe, looks at the inside into the nail, into the, find the nail that has been hurting her. Or the woman on the street corner eating the plums. They taste good to her, they taste good to her, they taste good to her. So Eliot said, I like your characters, let's have more of them. And with three young men, that bastard, he didn't give me credit for writing an American. He still wanted to put it into an English context. He still wanted to interpret what I was doing as some kind of English historical repeat. It was amazing, he really was mad at Eliot. Mm-hmm. And I remember him saying that he was so smart, Eliot was such a great poet, that he'd set English poetry back, American poetry back 25 years, because, which is, I think, something he's written down elsewhere. We talked to William one time, went over, he had a friend, Kitty Hoagland, whose husband was an editor of the New York Herald Tribune, a newspaper at that time. Perhaps might have had an affair with Kitty Hoagland. She lived down the block from him, a few blocks away in Rutherford. And one Sunday we went over to Kitty Hoagland's house. She's still alive, I think. Hosts parties, you know, in William's memorial situations. Takes part in the celebrations of Williams in Rutherford, I think, or as part of that. People who remember Williams there. And we got it talking about Dylan Thomas, who just died. And I said, what do you think of him? Knowing that Williams was not up Dylan Thomas's alley, or they were totally different. He said, well, he was a poet. And because he was a poet, he was an honorable man. Anybody who's a poet must be. Anybody who has that ambition to work with language, even if his poetry is of another kind, still he certainly was a poet. So he was picking up on Dylan Thomas for the romantic poet part, which was kind of interesting for Williams to the doctor, who came on as if he was just a doctor at that moment, anyway, at that year, to genuflect to Dylan Thomas just for the idealistic notion of him being a poet. Gertrude Stein, I asked him about, said she had one very simple idea, which he did over and over again, but it was a real thing. One real simple idea which he worked with in many different ways. Pound, he has a mystical ear, he said, I've never found. I never forget that. Pound has a mystical ear.
Melville, did he?
No, we never talked about Melville. Hemingway, I forgot what he said something about it. He was talking about people he knew. Mayakovsky he met. He said in the 20s, the great Russian poet, Mayakovsky, had come to New York, and Williams had gone into Greenwich Village to hear him. Some little hall where Mayakovsky had read, and possibly not for many people, you know, maybe 50 people or so, or 20 people. Mm-hmm. And then after, Williams was introduced to Mayakovsky. And Williams always remembered what he said to Mayakovsky. Mayakovsky asked him, what did you think? Or in Russian, and the interpreter said, what did you think of the reading? And because Mayakovsky had orated and made a big sound. And Williams said, pointed to the table, you laid an egg. In English it means you're a lousy performance. Or however, because of the nature of the image, what Williams really meant was you put something solid on the table. You laid an egg. something that would hatch. Uh-huh. But mainly what Williams explained to me, I said, why was that funny? He said, because what it meant one way, but the other way, what I really meant, quite literally, that could be translated, because they literally put something solid on the table. That's really pure Williams's humor. Uh-huh. Like an appreciation of language and turning it upside down and cleaning it out. And then using it in an unusual way, but real, using vernacular in an unusual way.
Can we talk about his poetics just for a little while? And so much depends on a red wheelbarrow. I was just reading the other day of Sid Corman saying of going to college and having that poem presented to him as an example of a fraud.
Yeah, of a fraudulent poem.
A fraudulent poem.
Yeah, it was for a long while. I remember my father used to say that. What does that mean? And it was the favorite fraudulent poem of all the people who hated modern poetry.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And it's, well, and it's still, I mean, it's still in a very succinct way. I mean, there's still, that problem still exists. And there's,
well, one interesting thing about it, we were just today working with a group of deaf poets, trying to translate that into a deaf sign language, or sign language for the deaf. And although some simpler poems of Langston Hughes, like life without love is like a broken-winged bird. Life without hope or love is like a frozen field. Those are relatively easy to translate. But when it came to translate the subtle pictorial, visual detail,
mm-hmm,
of wheelbarrow, a red wheelbarrow glazed with rain water. That's an extremely subtle noticing as a picture thing. There's nothing fraudulent about the delicacy of that. A red wheelbarrow glazed with rainwater. Because then, if you're trying to translate it into sign language or any other language, you have to figure out, is it still raining? Has it been raining and is it iced over now?
Mm-hmm.
Or is it a glaze because the thing is still wet and streaming with water, or is it a glaze because it's cold out? And you really, you begin to realize how complicated that is. It sure gives you a great picture, the red wheelbarrow glazed with rainwater. It's a very vivid picture of the shine, the glaze. But to try and translate it into sign language presented the problem that, first of all, the guy had translated as wet with rainwater, as if the rain is running on it. To do the glazed, you would have had to take a little more trouble and explain all the glazed part, not only wet, but glazed, the shine. So you realize in that simple little thing, hardly fake at all, he built into it, he's got a very subtle piece of optical information.
Mm-hmm. And also the fact that no one is let off the hook by the poetic device of comparing it,
mm-hmm,
to something else. It's, yeah, the thing itself.
That aspect of Williams reminds me of a great statement by a Tibetan Lama that I learned a lot from, who said, things are symbols of themselves. Things are symbols of themselves. Which is basically the idea of no idea in things also. Williams' slogan, no idea but in things. Why? Because things are symbols of themselves. In the meditative Zen or Tibetan tradition is that through meditation practice, one focuses one's attention on the actual appearance of the world, finally, single-mindedly. And so, because of unobstructed observation, unobstructed view, unobstructed direct contact, or as Zukovsky says, sight is where the vision, or sight is where the eye hits.
Mm-hmm.
Because view is unobstructed by thought screens interposing. Details of green prongs of vegetable matter become more luminous. The red becomes redder, and yellow becomes yellower. Because they're not trying to interpret anything out of them, they just become themselves, pure red and pure, or orange and, uh-huh, yellow. So things are symbols of themselves when there's an unobstructed observation, when you're not trying to interpret.
So by saying that A equals A, as opposed to A equals B, which is the,
yeah,
Western poetic.
You don't distract the mind from looking at the object you're describing.
Mm-hmm.
You don't try and cut it up. Or as Burroughs said, the most unhappy thing is to be making love to one person and thinking of another. So, to be looking, so in a sense, it's a very unhappy thing to be. My love is like a red, red rose.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be a funny contradiction.
Yeah. Does anybody want to ask anything while we're going on here?
I see. So much depends upon a red wheelbarrow,
yeah,
as being very regular in terms of the beats in the line. I mean,
yeah,
for example,
I'm not sure that I've got it written down exactly as it is.
I think you do, but it's pretty much 2-1, 2-1, 2-1 all the way down, just as though he had really contrived it. If you tried to,
I don't know where the law belongs beside the white.
Well, if you just take the heavy accents, so much, you have two there, depends one, on and red.
Well, I hear different. I don't follow the accent. I follow the count of syllables. So much depends. That's equal. Upon a red. Da 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 da. 1, 2, 3, 4. Wheelbarrow. So much depends. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2. 1, 2. 1, 2. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2. So much.
Well, you do hear the regularity, though.
Well, regularity or variations from regularity. One or the other.
Yeah.
Glazed with red. Then a three. Glazed with rain.
Yes.
So much depends upon a red. Wheelbarrow. Then he compromises.
Yeah.
Glazed with rain. So there's three. So you have 2, 2, 4, wheelbarrow, three. Upon a red, wheelbarrow. Then that's repeated, glazed with rain. Wheelbarrow, glazed with rain. Water. Back to the two. Beside the white. Maybe, I don't know, how is it? Beside the white? Or beside the? I don't know what his original
is. I see it as a matter of how you do it, though.
Yeah.
In terms of your own voice.
One
but it seems just as regular to me as...
One thing that he does, in his later poems, which are broken up to triadic lines, lines coming across the page in series of three, when you hear him read it on his recordings, which are very beautiful recordings, that he made when he was very old and had had a stroke, and his voice is utterly sincere and full of interesting emotional tones, variations of pitch, high tones, delicate tones. He doesn't follow the line breaks. He just reads it as if it is prose. So he's not paying that much of attention in that sense. I think he's interested in arranging it on the page in some kind of mindful way to indicate parts of thoughts balanced together, parts of phrasing balanced together, pieces of ideas set up and balanced together, pivoting maybe on and or. You know, you might occasionally have just a in the middle of the three-line triadic, you might have or as the middle, where on which the other two parts balance. A few times you might have a single word. Yeah.
He was never satisfied with the kind that he had found the prosody he was looking for until perhaps Asphodel.
Yeah.
Right? He was dissatisfied with the prosody of everything.
Yeah. What? Well, his dissatisfaction was he figured we had opened up the old form.